Turn in your Bibles, please, to Exodus chapter 1. We're going to read just a few verses from Exodus. Obviously, when we're looking, giving an overview of a book, it's impossible to go verse by verse in one session. But we want to read every time some verses that will kind of help us set the context for our overview of the book. And tonight, we're looking at chapter 1, verses 5 to 8. And we're thinking about this book, Exodus, the second book of the Bible, the second book in the Pentateuch, that is the five books of the law, as a book that tells us about the people of God being rescued by the lawgiver, by the God who gives them the law. Stand with me if you would, and as I read these verses, I want to remind you that our theme passage, it's overriding this whole study of seeing Jesus in all of Scripture, is John 5, 39 and 40, which says, "You search the Scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they," that is the Scriptures, "that bear witness about me," and that's Jesus speaking, "yet you refuse to come to me, that you may have life." Exodus 1, 5 to 8. All the descendants of Jacob were 70 persons. Joseph was already in Egypt. Then Joseph died, and all his brothers and all that generation died. But the people of Israel were fruitful and increased greatly. They multiplied and grew exceedingly strong, so that the land was filled with them. Now there arose a new king over Egypt who did not know Joseph. This is the inerrant, infallible, all-sufficient word of God. We're going to, best we can, fly over the book of Moses tonight and see some things, hopefully learn some things, hopefully help you put some things together, piece some things together maybe you haven't done or you haven't done in a long time, and then see how our Lord Jesus Christ is typified, presented, and anticipated in this book. Thank you. Please be seated. I told you last week as we began the study of Genesis that Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy constitute five books that are known as the Law or the Pentateuch, which simply means five scrolls, five books. The Torah is another term for it. And so Genesis is the book of beginnings. We looked at that last week. Tonight we want to look at Exodus, and I want to give you just some thoughts about it. We're going to try to do this with every one of these books. The key idea in Exodus is redemption. As it has to do with the nation, they are going to be a delivered nation in this book. We're going to see, in fact, it's the first time the word redemption comes up. They're going to be redeemed at the Passover. God's character here, this may strike some people as odd, but his character here is that he is merciful. This in the context of the book, one of the books, you're going to see this again in Deuteronomy when he gives the law again. But in the book that tells us about the Ten Commandments and begins to tell us about the 630 attending laws, commandments, he's merciful. His role in this book is one of deliverer. He rescues his people from bondage. And the command, just like in Genesis, the command was "let there be," which emphasized his creative activity. In Exodus, it's "let my people go." Historical context. Jacob's descendants have moved from Canaan to Egypt. Remember, we talked about that last week. There was a famine that arose. Joseph had dreams about it, which is what got him thrown into a pit and sold into slavery. They moved from Canaan to Egypt, and because Joseph has died, who was a vice regent, second in command in Egypt, because Joseph has died, they are now suffering under the bondage of a new Pharaoh, as the text we read, a Pharaoh who rose up, didn't know Joseph. He knew about Joseph, but he didn't care about Joseph's influence. He didn't care about the people that Joseph brought down there with him. He just didn't care. And so after a period of 400 years, they cry to God for deliverance. And God responds by empowering Moses to stand before Pharaoh and create these 10 devastating plagues that God brings, leading up to their delivery, their redemption. After their redemption, the Passover, the Israelites leave Egypt, cross the Red Sea, journey to Mount Sinai. And there God reveals his covenant law and gives them the pattern for building the tabernacle. They've grown. In fact, the estimates are 2 to 3 million strong in Egypt. They're an infant nation. But you'll know if you've read through this portion of the Bible that they have never governed themselves. They're a nation of people, yes. They're recognized as a separate people, yes. But they've never had the opportunity to take any authority to shape their own laws and destiny. They've always been under the rule. All these people that are alive, all they've ever known is the rule of the Egyptians. They cross the sea. They journey to Mount Sinai. And there God reveals his covenant law and gives them the pattern for the building of the tabernacle. And so we're going to see here tonight a mass migration of this nation that moves into the wilderness. There's a division of the book into two parts, and it's all one book, but you'll notice the different emphases. In the first part of the book is the redemption from Egypt, chapters 1 to 18, and then the second part is revelation from God, where he's giving them his statutes. This redemption from Egypt, they have descended from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It's interesting, if you follow Moses' life, God has been preparing Moses for this. I heard a preacher preach years ago, and he said, Moses is an interesting biographical study. The first 40 years of his life, he was in the court of Pharaoh, and he thought he was somebody. When he commits murder and runs for his life, he is banished from that court. So he said the second 40 years of his life he spent as a shepherd on the backside of Mount Horeb, realizing he was a nobody. So he moves from somebody to nobody. And he said, but the last 40 years of his life, when God summons him and brings him back to lead the Exodus, he discovers how God can take someone who thought he was a somebody and discovered he's a nobody and make him again a somebody for his purposes. And that's kind of a good little way to remember the life of Moses, 40-year segments. And so God's been preparing him for this. He will be uniquely qualified to stand before Pharaoh because he's grown up in that house. Very unlikely. Think about the providence of God in getting all this to happen, because he's Jewish born and Egyptian raised. And we remember the encounter that Pharaoh says, who is this God that I should obey his voice to let people, Israel, go? Remember, the Pharaoh is, if you break his name down, Ra was the sun god in this pantheon of Egyptian gods, and there were thousands of them. Ra was the most powerful, and it was believed by the Egyptians that the Pharaoh was the human representation of Ra. So he was the most powerful. He was himself, in the eyes of the Egyptians, a embodied manifestation of Ra, the sun god. And so he would bow to no one. He would see himself as supreme. And you'll know that God walks Egypt through these 10 plagues. We're going to see something about those. Until he finally brings the final death knell, literally, which becomes the background for the Passover to be instituted. And it's those who believe Moses' message that they need to slaughter an innocent lamb, a pure lamb, and paint the blood of that lamb over the doorposts. It's those that need to, that believe that will be the ones who will be delivered out of Egyptian bondage. And then, of course, he guides them. This is fascinating if you read the narrative. They're in the desert of Sinai. In the day, it is blistering hot. And if you're familiar with deserts in that sort of parallel across those ribbons around the globe, it's unbearably hot in the day. And then the temperatures drop down to really, really frigid many times at night. And so God leads them in this wilderness wandering as a pillar of cloud in the day, so that wherever they're traveling, 2 to 3 million people, they are traveling under the cloud. It's interesting when they grumble, when you read the grumblings in the Exodus, one thing you never hear them grumbling about is the heat. They grumble about the food, they grumble about water, but they never grumble about the heat. This cloud covers them. And then at night, that pillar of cloud turns into a pillar of fire. And so they have warmth over them to protect them. And God sustains them throughout their journeys. And so what you see in Exodus 1:1 through 18:27, you see this movement of this need of redemption, then a preparation for redemption, then the redemption itself, and then the preservation after that. I want us to watch just real quickly part one. We're going to go to the Read Scripture Bible Project materials and let you see them introduce this first part, and then we'll introduce the second part in a moment.
The book of Exodus. The book of
it's
Exodus.
The second book of
it's
the Bible.
The second book
picks up
of the
storyline from the previous book, Genesis,
from the previous book,
which ended
Genesis,
with Abraham's
which
grandson,
ended with Abraham's
Jacob,
grandson,
leading
Jacob,
his large family,
leading
of, 70
his large
down
family
down
of 70 people.
Now
down
Jacob's
Egypt.
11th
now
son
Jacob's
Joseph
11th
had been
son,
elevated
Joseph,
to second
been
in
elevated
command
to second
Egypt,
in command,
and he had saved
Egypt,
his whole family,
and he had saved his whole
and
family.
And so Pharaoh, the king of Egypt,
and so Pharaoh, the king of Egypt,
offered the family to come live there.
And so eventually Jacob dies.
So eventually Jacob dies,
and Joseph and all his brothers,
and Joseph and all his brothers.
About 400 years passed.
About 400 years.
Story of the Exodus
and the story of the
now that name refers to the event.
Now that name refers to
the
event
that takes place
in
the
first
half
Exodus
from
Egypt.
Israel's Exodus.
But the book has a second half.
But the book has a second half that takes place at the
in this video we'll just focus on the first half.
In this video we'll just focus on the
first
half
where
centuries
were fruitful
and
the
Israelites were
fruitful and
multiplied.
Now this line is a deliberate echo.
Now this line is a deliberate echo
back to the blessing that God gave all humanity.
And it reminds us of the big biblical story.
And it reminds us of
big
humanity forfeited
so
God's
far.
Blessing.
Humanity
forfeited God's
so
blessing.
God chose Abraham's
family,
and so God chose
Abraham's
through which
he
would restore his blessing.
Through which
he would restore his
but
blessing.
But the new Pharaoh does not
view
Israel.
But the new Pharaoh does not
he actually
view
thinks
Israel
this
growing
as
Israelite
he
immigrant group is
growing
Israelite
power.
Immigrant
and
group.
And so just as in Genesis,
humanity
rebels
against
God's blessing, so
humanity rebels against
Pharaoh
God's
attempts
blessing.
To destroy the source of
Pharaoh attempts to destroy the source of
He brutally enslaves them in forced labor.
He brutally
and then he
enslaves
orders
them
that all the Israelite boys
and then he
be
orders
drowned
that all
the
Israelite boys
now Pharaoh,
be drowned
he is the
in the
worst
Nile.
Character in the Bible
now
so
Pharaoh,
far.
He is
the worst character
in the Bible so far.
Humanity's
his kingdom
epitomizes.
Pharaoh has so redefined good
God.
And evil.
Pharaoh has so redefined good and evil.
The murder of
his
innocent children has
that even the murder of innocent
and so
children
Egypt
has
become
worse than Babylon.
And so Egypt
has become worse
than
Babylon.
So now Israel cries out for help against
this new
Babylon.
So now Israel cries out for help against this new Babylon.
God first turns Pharaoh's evil upside down.
God first
as an
turns
Israelite
Pharaoh's
evil
upside
her boy
down
into the Nile
as an Israelite
river,
mother
but in a
throws
basket.
Her boy
and
into
so he
the
floats
Nile
safely
river,
right
but
down
in a basket.
Into Pharaoh's
and so he floats
family.
Safely right
he's
down
named
into
Moses,
Pharaoh's
and he grows up
family.
To eventually become
he's
the man
Moses,
that God will use
and he grows
to
up to
eventually
Pharaoh's
become
evil.
The man that
in the
God
famous
will
story
use
of the burning
defeat,
bush
God appears to Moses
in the famous story of the burning
go to Pharaoh
God appears
order him to release
Israel to go to Pharaoh
and God says
order him to release
Pharaoh will resist
and
so
God says
bring his judgment
Pharaoh
will resist
and
so he will bring his
then
judgment
God also
on
says
Egypt
that he will harden
plagues.
Pharaoh's
then God also says
so
that
we're
he
introduced
will harden
the next
Pharaoh's
main part of
heart.
The story the
and so we're introduced
God
to the next main part of the story
now
the confrontation
what does this mean
between
that God
says he'll
Pharaoh.
Harden Pharaoh's
now
heart.
What does this mean
it's
that God
super important
says he'll
to
harden
read this
Pharaoh's
section of the story
heart.
Really closely
it's super
in
important
sequence.
To read this section
in
of
Moses
the story
and Pharaoh's
really
first
closely
encounter we're told simply simply that Pharaoh's heart
in Moses and Pharaoh's first encounter,
there's no implication
that Pharaoh's heart grew hard.
And so in response,
there's no implication that God set a five plagues.
And so in response,
each one
God
confronting Pharaoh and one of his Egyptian gods.
Each one confronting Pharaoh and one of his Egyptian gods.
Pharaoh to humble himself.
And each time,
and to let the Israelites
Moses
go.
Offers a chance
but after
for
each
Pharaoh
plague,
to humble
told
himself.
That Pharaoh
and to let
either hardened his heart,
but after that his plague, we're told that Pharaoh either hardened his heart,
and so eventually it's with the second set of five plagues that we begin to hear how God hardened Pharaoh's heart.
So the point of the story seems to be this:
how God,
even though God knew that Pharaoh would
the point of the story
will,
seems
God
to be
still
this.
Offered
even
him
though
all of
God
these
knew that Pharaoh
right
would
thing.
Resist his will,
but eventually
God still
Pharaoh's
offers him
evil
all these chances
reaches a point
to
of
do
no
the
return.
Right thing.
I mean, even his
but
own
eventually
advisors
Pharaoh's
think
evil
that he's lost
reaches a point of
and
no
it's
return.
At that
I mean, even
point
his own
that
God
advisors
takes over
think
and bends Pharaoh's evil towards his own redemption.
That God takes over,
God lures
Pharaoh
into his own destruction
towards his own
saves his
people.
God lures Pharaoh into his own
final plague. It's the night of
Passover, and God turns the tables on Pharaoh
with the final plague.
He
the
killed
Passover.
The sons of the
and God turns the tables
so God
on
will
Pharaoh.
Kill the firstborn
just
in
as he
Egypt
killed the sons
the
of the Israelites.
But
so
unlike
God
Pharaoh,
will
God
kill
provides
the firstborn
a means
in Egypt
of escape
with a final plague
through the blood.
But unlike Pharaoh, God provides
here the story
a means
of
introduces us through
in
the blood to the
lamb.
Annual Israelite
and here
ritual
the story stops
Passover.
And introduces
on the night
us
before Israel left Egypt,
the annual Israelite
young spotless lamb.
On the night before Israel left Egypt, they sacrificed
a young spotless
lamb.
And when the divine plague came over
and painted
the house
on the door
covered with the blood of the lamb,
and when
were
the divine plague
over,
came
and the
sun
over
spared.
Egypt, the
and
house
so
is covered with the blood of the lamb.
The Israelites have reenacted
over,
that
and the sun
to
spared.
Remember
and
so
to
every
year
since just
the Israelites have reenacted that night.
But Pharaoh, because
remember,
of his pride
and
to celebrate, and
he
loses his own son
and his mercy.
And he's compelled to
but
finally
Pharaoh,
let
because
the
of his pride and rebellion,
and so the Israelite slaves make their
and he's compelled to finally.
But no sooner do they leave that Pharaoh,
so the Israelite slaves make
he gathers his army and chases after
no sooner
the Israelites.
Leave,
final
Pharaoh
showdown.
Changes his mind.
As the Israelites
he gathers his army and chases
the
after
safely.
The Israelites for
Pharaoh
a final
charges
showdown.
Towards his
as
own
the Israelites pass
Exodus
through
story
the waters of the sea
with
safely.
The first song of praise
Pharaoh
in the Bible.
Charges
it's called the song of the sea and the final
Exodus
line
story
declares
concludes
that the
with
Lord
the first song
reigns
praise
as
the Bible
it's called the song
and then
the
song
sea.
Retells
and the final
in
line
poetry,
declares
the
story
the
Lord
of God's kingdom
reigns
is all
about
it's about
how God
and
is
then
on
the song
retells
in
poetry
with the story
and to redeem those who are
about it's about how God is on a mission
God is going
to
bring his people
in
into
world,
the promised
and
land
to redeem
where
his those
who are
enslaved
to will
evil.
Live among them.
God is going to
this
bring his
story
people
is what
into
it looks
the
like
promised
God
land
where
his
divine
presence
his people
will live among them.
So after the Israelites sing their song,
what
the story
looks like
takes
when
a sharp
God becomes
turn.
King.
The Israelites they're trekking through the wilderness
so after
on
the
their
Israelites
way to Mount
sing
Sinai,
their song,
the
story
takes a
they're
sharp
thirsty,
turn.
And they start the
criticizing Moses and God
the wilderness on their way to Mount Sinai. And they're hungry.
They say they long for the good old days.
Criticizing Moses and God for even
so God graciously provides food
and water.
They long for the good old days,
but these stories
I mean,
they
cast
a
dark
shadow. So God graciously
shadow.
Provides
and
food
we begin
and water
to wonder,
Israel
could it
in
be
the wilderness?
But
Israel's
heart
stories
is just
they
as hard
cast
as
a dark shadow.
We shall see.
And we begin
for now,
to wonder, could it
first
be
half of
that
the
Israel's
device.
Heart is just as hard as Pharaoh's?
We shall see.
But for now, that's the first half of the book of Exodus.
Okay, and so the first half, of course, is about redemption. The second half is about revelation or instruction. We want to look at that for a few minutes, chapters 19 to 40, before we show you the second video. They've experienced God's deliverance, his guidance, his protection. They should be ready to be taught and be recipients, be happy recipients of God's teaching. He's going to show them how to be set apart to walk with him, after him, and to reflect him. It's the law that's given on Sinai, the Ten Commandments. It's what we call God's moral law, summarily comprehended, or comprehended in a summary form in the Ten Commandments. The law that God will give in Exodus and then in Leviticus and in Deuteronomy is of three types. It's moral law. It is also what you would call ceremonial law. A lot of the book of Leviticus is about how they go through the ceremonies. And then civil law, the civil law being the law that they as an identifiable people would keep and by which they would be ordered and guided to keep them relatively ethnically pure from other peoples. because Messiah will come out of them. When Messiah comes, he is the fulfillment of the ceremonial law. So all the ceremonies, all the types will fall aside. When Messiah comes, Israel as a nation, this is hard for some people to lay hold of, but Israel as a nation will have fulfilled its function as a nation. And so the civil laws will go by the wayside. There are principles in them that obtain, but in terms of the civil laws as legislation, they go by the wayside. But it's the moral law, summarized in the Ten Commandments, that obtains and abides and carries on, we would say, into perpetuity, because when you're saved, that law is the law written on your heart. We're going to be seeing that when we get into the prophets. And that law, when we come into heaven, will be how everyone will live without straining, without struggling, as we're glorified in heaven. And so these, when you hear the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20, verses 1 to 17, this is moral law. There's 630 commandments, and then others falling out from that that take in the body of law of ceremonial and fleshing out some moral application, and also the civil law. So I hope you understand the three, it's called the three branches of the law. Reasonable men differ about this, to be honest, full disclosure. Some will say that the fourth commandment, the Sabbath, is ceremonial, maybe even civil, but not moral. In other words, it shouldn't carry over. We taught through this several years ago. I won't go back and do that again. But simple to say that even in the way God structured the Ten Commandments, you've got to get through three, which are clearly unchanging, to get to the fourth, or you've got to come through the back door of principles that obtain today. And so I think it's a mistake to suggest that the fourth commandment does not have a moral meaning today. So I'd commend to you Walt Chantry's book, if you want to do some more reading on this, called The Sabbath, A Delight. It's an excellent treatise of this. But that's the law that's going to be given at Sinai. And so you see this revelation from God is a revelation of the covenant and then a response of Israel to the covenant. It would be great to read that Israel embraced it, because they do verbally say, all that you've said we will do. But they get very impatient and they immediately break the covenant, particularly the first two, that you shall have no other gods before me and you shall not make unto yourself any graven image. And of course we know that while Moses was away on the mountain and they got impatient thinking Moses may have died on the mountain, for all we know he's dead up there, they convinced Aaron to take jewelry and put it into a molten pot, and out they formed this cow, this golden cow. And you remember when Moses chides them, it's funny if it's not so tragic, when Moses says, what's happened here? They say, well, we just put all this stuff in the pot and this cow came out. Well, we know that didn't happen. They actually took time to shape it and form it. And so they break the covenant set forth in the Ten Commandments just almost immediately. So let's watch now the part two of the Bible Project, the second half, second part, chapters 19 to 40.
The Book of Exodus.
The book of Exodus.
In the first video, we explore chapters 1 through 18, which tell the foundational story of how God rescued the enslaved Israelites by confronting and defeating Pharaoh, while offering a way of escape through the blood of the Passover.
God then delivered his people
through the waters of the sea, and then into the wilderness, where they grumbled and complained.
Now the second half of the Book of Exodus opens as Moses leads Israel to the foot of Mount Sinai,
where God invites the nation to enter into a covenant relationship.
And here we reach another key moment in the biblical storyline, because this is picking up and developing God's promise to Abraham.
So remember, from the book of Genesis, God promised that through Abraham's family somehow he would restore his blessing to all of the nations.
And here we find out God says that if Israel obeys the terms of the covenant, they will be so shaped by God's laws and teaching and justice that they will become a kingdom
kingdom of priests, which means that they will become God's representatives and show all of the other nations what God is truly like.
Now the people of Israel eagerly accept the offer.
And so God's presence appears right on the top of Mount Sinai in the form of cloud and lightning and thunder.
And Moses goes up as their representative, and God opens with the basic terms of the covenant, the famous Ten Commandments. These are like the basic terms of the agreement, how the Israelites and God are going to relate to each other. And then after this come another collection of commands, which fill out the first ten in more detail. There are laws about Israel's worship, about social justice, how they are to live together, all shaping Israel into a nation of justice and generosity that's different from the other nations.
So Moses writes down all these laws, and he brings them down to the people who, again, eagerly agree to enter into this covenant with God.
And once they do so, God takes the relationship forward another step.
He tells Moses that he wants his holy divine presence to come and dwell right in the midst of Israel,
which develops another aspect of God's covenant promise.
So remember, after humanity's rebellion in the garden, it was access to God's presence that was lost.
But now, through the family of Abraham, God's presence is becoming once again accessible.
Through this covenant relationship, first with Israel, and then somehow one day to all nations.
So what follows are seven chapters of detailed architectural blueprints, sacred tent, the tabernacle, the outer room, and then the center there's an outer room, and then inside the inner room, the holy space is a golden box of the Ark, and there's angelic creatures and angelic creatures over the top of it. It's the hot spot of the presence. There's lots of detail, and it's important to know that every piece has some kind of symbolic flowers, the angels, the gold, and the jewels that all echoes back to the garden, the place where God and humans live together.
So the tabernacle is like
so the tabernacle
the
is like
a portable place where God and Israel can live together.
At the camp, Israelites, so they ask Moses, his brother Aaron, to make for them a golden worship at the golden calf idol. Moses' brother Aaron, to make for them a golden worship at the calf idol. So they ask Moses' brother Aaron to make for them a golden worship at the calf idol. Breaking the fear of the Israelites, and now God's presence is breaking the fear of the Israelites. So he first invites Moses into his own anger. He tells Moses what he wants to do. But Moses intercedes by appealing to God. And then Moses appeals to God's reputation among the nations. What would they think?
So God accepts Moses' intercession.
And Moses appeals to God's reputation among the nations. What would they think?
So God accepts Moses' intercession.
God accepts the tent.
So he first invites Moses into his own anger.
He tells Moses what he wants to do.
And he tells Moses what he wants to do. But Moses intercedes by appealing to God.
Moses intercedes.
He says, first of all, destroying Israel would be going backwards.
Destroying Israel would be going back.
And then Moses appeals to God's reputation among the nations. What would they think?
So God accepts Moses' intercession.
So God accepts the tent.
Moses' intercession.
So God accepts the tent.
So he first invites Moses into his own anger.
He tells Moses what he wants to do.
And he tells Moses what he wants to do.
But Moses intercedes by appealing to God.
Moses intercedes.
He says, first of all, destroying Israel would be going back And that's how the book ends.
It's really surprising, but not really.
That's how the book ends.
You can see now how much Israel sin has damaged the relationship.
You can see now how much Israel sin has damaged the relationship.
So the book opened, remember, with Pharaoh's evil threatening Israel and threatening God's covenant promise.
But now, as the book ends,
Israel has become its own worst enemy.
But now, as the book ends,
Israel has become its own worst enemy.
And so the question as the book closes is, how is God going to reconcile this?
The question as the book closes is, how is God going to reconcile this conflict
with the sinful corruption of his own goodness and his presence?
The solution to that problem is what the next book is about.
But for now,
that solution to that problem is what the next book is about. But for now, that's the book of Exodus.
You are following the Bible Project readings, you know that tomorrow you begin the book of Leviticus, just what he's talking about there. And I hope you will take advantage of these. I find these videos very compelling, very educational. It captures an awful lot in an awful little time. And so let's talk briefly about, speaking of time, place and time. The whole episode of Egypt takes place over about 430 years, and that would carry, if you're reading through Exodus 1:1 to chapter 13, verse 16. Then they wander in the wilderness for about 2 months, and that's Exodus 13:17 through 18:27. And then they spend about 10 months at the foot of Mount Sinai, and that's covered in Exodus 19:1 through 40:38. I said earlier that the book of Exodus is a record of Israel's birth as a nation. They go down as a family of 70, and they produce, taking seriously the admonition, be fruitful and multiply, and they become a nation of 2 to 3 million people. The Hebrew title for it is a multi-syllabic Hebrew term, which literally means, and these are the names, because that's how the book opens up. These are the names of the generations. Now the word Exodus is a Greek word, which means to exit, to depart, to go out, and we'll see how that was used in Jesus' ministry when he speaks of his own. And the word in the passage is Exodus. So let's look at the use of the word a little bit here in Exodus 19:1. We're told on the third new moon, after the people of Israel had gone out, there's the word in Hebrew, of the land of Egypt, on that day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. And so it refers to their leaving as this going out, this word that in the Greek is Exodus, and in the Hebrew is a word that if I tried to pronounce it, it would scare all of you. So in the New Testament, however, in Luke 9, verse 31, we're told that Jesus on what we call the Mount of Transfiguration appeared in glory. And remember that when Peter, James, and John were there, that Jesus was transfigured, he appeared in glory, and that Moses and Elijah were there. Moses representing the law, Elijah representing the prophets. And so you have Jesus communing with the titular head combined of the entire Old Covenant, the body of material that we know as the Old Testament, carrying from the Book of Beginnings all the way to the end of the prophets, and the various ministrations of the covenant renewal all throughout that. And so this is Jesus communing with the law and the prophets, and it says here that he spoke of his departure. The word departure there, if you could read the Greek, looks like Exodus, except the chi is makes a k sound, but it, for all the world, looks like an X. Exodus, we'll say. He spoke to them. Think about that. He's talking to Moses about his coming Exodus, when he will, according to the New Testament, lead captivity captive. He will take them out of bondage. He'll take us out of bondage. And so he's having that communion, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. And then Peter, in 2 Peter 1:15, says, I will make every effort so that after my departure, and that's just another use of the term, it's the word Exodus or Exodus, you may be able at any time to recall these things. And so you see the use of the word Old Testament and New Testament, and that's where the book Exodus comes to us with its name from the Greek description of it. It also is used to speak of physical death in the New Testament. So it embodies this theme of redemption, being brought from death to life. And the Latin term, if you're interested in that, is Liber Exodus, which means the book of departure. The authorship of it, we talked a little bit last week about the authorship of the Pentateuch, of Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. And Mosaic authorship is accepted by conservative scholars. We'll just give you some of the brief external evidence. If you look at Joshua 8, 30 to 32, so now Joshua has taken the lead after the death of Moses. He said, at that time, Joshua built an altar to the Lord, the God of Israel, on Mount Ebal, just as Moses, the servant of the Lord, had commanded the people of Israel, as it is written in the book of the law of Moses. You see the citation there. And this is not the only place in the Old Testament. There are several where the book of Moses, the book of the law that Moses wrote, is cited. This is what we call internal or external evidence of the authorship of Moses. There are other biblical writers. Malachi, the last prophet, says in Malachi 4:4, remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules that I commanded him at Horeb for Israel. So here's Malachi speaking for God, assigning Mosaic authorship to the law. The disciples references. Look at John chapter 1, verse 45. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. So he is cited as having written about Jesus of Nazareth. And then Paul in Romans 10:5, he says, for Moses writes about the righteousness that is based on the law, that the person who does the commandments shall live by them. So he's citing Moses as the author of the law. And then Jesus used references to Moses. And I'm just going to cite a few of them for you to see where Jesus embraced and asserted the Mosaic authorship. Mark 10:7, for Moses said, honor your father and your mother. So there, of course, he is citing the fifth commandment in Exodus 20. And then whoever reviles father or mother must surely die. And Mark 12:26, as for the dead being raised, Jesus is engaging the Sadducees here, didn't believe in the resurrection. Have you not read in the book of Moses, in the passage about the bush, so he's citing the burning bush and the book of Moses, this book authored by Moses, how God spoke to him saying, I'm the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And then Luke 20, verse 37, but that the dead are raised, even Moses showed in the passage about the bush. And that's just a citation again to show that two gospel writers cite Moses' authorship about the same episode. And then John 5, 46 and 47. For if you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. And there's this further confirmation that the Old Testament, if you're seeking life. And remember now, the Old Testament was the New Testament age era's book of evangelism. That's where they did their evangelism from. They were writing the New Testament. If you believe Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my word? And so it's a challenge to those who would say, well, I believe the Torah, but I don't believe you're the Messiah. Jesus says that's an impossibility. If you believe the Torah, you'd believe me. If you don't believe me, you really don't believe the writings. Then again in John 7:19, has not Moses given you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me? In other words, why would you want to break the sixth commandment in the name of upholding the law? Then John 7:22 and 23, Moses gave you circumcision, not that it's from Moses, but from the fathers, and you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If on the Sabbath a man receives circumcision so that the law of Moses may not be broken, are you angry with me because on the Sabbath I made a man whole, a man's body, whole body well? And so again, just we see Jesus arguing with them, citing Moses as the author. And then of course, one of our videos referenced this song of the sea in Exodus 15:1, then Moses and the people of Israel sang this song to the Lord, saying, I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously, the horse and his rider he's thrown into the sea. And they sang that, of course, after God had drowned the Egyptian army. When I was in seminary, there was a fellow who told me about this. I was not in the class, but was talking to his professor, one of his Old Testament professors, and the professor said, now, the Red Sea, of course, we know was the Reed Sea, and it was called the Reed Sea because it was shallow enough that you could see the reeds growing up out of it. And so the idea that the two walls of water were parted and people walked over, that's just not supported by what we know historically. And so this student, who was just a pretty straightforward, simple guy, said, well, professor, if what you say is true, then you have opened my eyes to a miracle that I have never seen before. What you're telling me is that God destroyed the entire Egyptian army in about 6 to 12 inches of water. So it's one way to look at it. We know that the Red Sea, at certain portions, was indeed a fairly deep body of water. In fact, there have been archaeological digs in recent years that have begun to find what looks like the remains of Egyptian chariots at the bottom of the Red Sea. How do you explain that? Then, of course, we reference the Ten Commandments, Exodus 21 through 17. I would remind you that the Ten Commandments, the moral law, begins with the language of redemption. Remember how it starts out? I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. So it's the context of commandments given is the language of redemption. I'm the Lord your God who redeemed you. I rescued you out of bondage, out of Egypt. And so in the light of my relationship to you as a redeemer, that I give you these laws. You shall have no other gods before me. And he goes down through the Ten Commandments. It's good to remember that. And then, of course, some more citation from within the book itself. Just real quickly, look at some passages from Exodus 24, verse 4. Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning, built an altar at the foot of the mountain, 12 pillars, according to the 12 tribes of Israel. Then again in verse 7, he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people, and they said, all that the Lord has spoken we will do, and we'll be obedient. And then in same chapter, verse 12, the Lord said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and wait here that I may give you the tablets of stone with the law and the commandment which I have written for their instruction. And then chapter 31, verse 18. And he gave to Moses, when he had finished speaking with him on Mount Sinai, the two tablets of the testimony, tablets of stone written with the finger of God. This is a witness within the book itself about how Moses took down what God told him. And then think about this. He wrote everything that we have recorded up to his death, everything except the Ten Commandments. They and they alone were written with the finger of God on tablets of stone. Everything else would have been on vellum or parchment, which could deteriorate. Tablets of stone remain. And so there's this powerful imagery here that ought to catch us and get our attention. That it's the Ten Commandments only that are etched on tablets of stone. The picture of what? That they should endure. And they're written with the finger of God. And that was my friend Errol Hultz in England who said one time when we were talking about this years ago, he said, Bill, he said, the scripture teaches that God is spirit and doesn't have a body like man. Our catechism teaches us that. What is the finger of God? When does God have fingers? And he said, God has fingers when Jesus comes in the flesh. So the Ten Commandments were written by the Son of God on tablets of stone. It is the law of Christ. And it really got me thinking. I hadn't, at that time in my ministry, hadn't taken that in. But it's pretty powerful to think about. Moses apparently records these things not in real time, but shortly after they happen. If we're going to try to assign a date, 1445 B.C. is considered a good solid date by those conservative scholars who have a high view of Scripture. And so this whole episode, the book was written during the 40-year wilderness journey between 1445 B.C. and 1405 B.C. One writer suggests that Moses probably kept an account of God's work, which he then edited in the plains of Moab shortly before his death. Exodus, the book itself, covers the period from the arrival of Jacob in Egypt to the erection of the tabernacle 431 years later in the wilderness, about 1445 B.C. There's two themes that run throughout Exodus. One is redemption. We see that portrayed in the Passover. The other is deliverance. So he redeems his people in a certain way, in a certain manner. I think it's interesting, and the fellows bring this out in the video. Pharaoh had purposed to destroy all firstborn male Israelites, to cut down the population and to head off a future generation. It was a form of genocide. I can't help but when I hear that or read about that, that a man could go so wrong and think he's doing right by killing babies. And I think where we are today, if you've watched events unfold, I actually was notified on email by a distant relative who took me to task for something. All I know is this person has the same last name I have. I never met him. And said to me in the course of the diatribe that Planned Parenthood is one of the greatest gifts to women and children that they've ever had. Now I'm deciding whether or not I want to take a swing at Tar Baby or just put my pearls back in my pocket. If I swing, though, I want to say to her, this is clearly an argument for silence, but I think it's fair to say the 57 million babies who have been slaughtered in the womb would take issue with your asserting that Planned Parenthood is a gift to them. People can go so wrong, and Pharaoh does that here, but the irony is that in the Passover, God reverses that. He spares anyone who has blood painted over the doorposts. And he takes the life of the firstborn in Egypt. He is merciful, slow to anger, abounding in love, forgiving sin. But he will not forgive the wicked. That is to say, he will not forgive the unrepentant. One of the commandments says that he is merciful. Forgive the iniquities. But he will deal with the sins to the third and fourth generation of them that hate him. Show mercy to thousands who love him and keep his commandments. And so Exodus is written portraying this birth of Israel as a nation that would be used by God to bring his rule on the earth. Moses leads them through this drama of redemption. It also shows God's hatred for idolatry, for false deity. Yahweh is revealed here as infinitely superior to any so-called gods. There is no equal, there is no match. And it teaches us that obedience to God is necessary for a redeemed people who've been set apart by him. The key word, as I said, is redemption. A couple of key verses, Exodus 6:6 and 19:5-6. Exodus 6:6 says, "Say therefore to the people of Israel, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians, and I will deliver you from slavery to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with great acts of judgment." You'll remember in the narrative, if you read it, or if you've read it recently, that Moses went to the people and they mocked him and they didn't want to have anything to do with him initially. It actually took God's miraculous manifestation of the plagues to get even the Israelites ready to leave. In Exodus 19, 5 and 6, "Now therefore, if you will indeed obey my voice and keep my covenants, you shall be my treasured possession among all peoples." That you hear that, and that goes back to the Abrahamic covenant made with Abraham and with Isaac and with Jacob. Same kind of language. "For all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the people of Israel." If you're looking for a bigger body of what we call key chapters, that would be chapters 12 to 14, where you have the salvation of Israel through the blood of the Passover, through the power of God as he takes them through the Red Sea on dry ground. And it's been suggested that Exodus is the central event of the Old Testament, just as the cross is the central event of the New Testament. Everything moves toward that in the Old Testament and looks back to that. And if you think about that and you read a lot of the Psalms, read a lot of the narrative poetry in the books that follow in the prophets, what are they always referencing? God delivering them from Egypt. It always goes back to that. And so Exodus is a very central book. What about Jesus Christ? Where do we see Jesus Christ in Exodus? Well, there's no direct messianic prophecies, but Exodus is full of types and portraits of Christ. And we're going to suggest seven to you. There's more that we could mine probably, but I think these highlight them. For example, when I don't have this written down specifically, when you see Moses pleading with God not to destroy Israel when they are sinning down in the valley, you cannot help but think of Jesus Christ, the high priest, praying on behalf of the people. And then even in heavenly session now, praying for his own, for those for whom he died. But let's look at how some of these things play out. Moses is a type of Christ. Deuteronomy 18, 15. "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen." That's interesting because you don't think of Moses, you see him as a patriarch, as the deliverer, but you don't think of him as a prophet. Yet he, under divine inspiration, says, "A prophet like me." Listen to him. What was it God said on the Mount of Transfiguration when Jesus was talking to Moses and Elijah? "This is my beloved son." Remember, Peter's just going, "Oh, this is wonderful. We need to build three tabernacles here. This is great. We can just stay up here. This is my beloved son. Listen to him." He is that prophet. So Moses is a type of Christ. He teaches us, shows us some things. There's some ways he's not like Christ. He in anger strikes a rock. And God says, you remember? He told him to strike the rock the first time and water came out. The second time he said, "Speak to the rock." And what did Moses do? He struck the rock. Because he disobeyed God and didn't speak to the rock. And the symbolism there is powerful. That I think it was Arthur Pink maybe who said that the rock was a type of Christ. And Paul says that in Galatians. You only had to strike him once. He was only going to be smitten once. After he's smitten, you speak to him. And Moses brought the rod down twice on the rock, and it disqualified him from taking them into the promised land. So there's some ways in which he's an antitype. He's not like Christ, but there's some ways that he is. Both Moses and Christ are prophets, priests, kings. And even though Moses was never officially crowned as a king, you cannot deny that he functioned in a patriarchal way as the ruler of Israel. In fact, it was his father-in-law, Jethro, who came and said, "You cannot keep this up. You cannot continue to sit and judge all the issues that come to you. You've got to break these people up into groups, or you're going to kill yourself." Both Jesus and Moses are kinsmen redeemers. Both lives are endangered in infancy. Both voluntarily renounce power and wealth. Both are deliverers, lawgivers, and mediators. So it's a powerful picture, this life of Moses, and how it foreshadows, anticipates the life of Jesus. Secondly, the Passover. Very obviously so. Look at a couple of verses that make it clear that Christ is our slain God and the Passover lamb. John 1:29. "The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." That's a direct reference to the role of the Lamb at Passover to expiate sin. Then John 1:36, he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." Same context there. Then 1 Corinthians 5:7, Paul is teaching them about this leaven that is corrupting the congregation there in Corinth, this immorality that's going on. He says, "Cleanse out the old leaven that you may be a new lump as you really are unleavened." In other words, the symbolism of the body of Christ as unleavened bread. There's no place for leaven in it. "For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed." So Paul directly identifies Jesus Christ with the Passover. Then the seven feasts, and it would take more time than we have tonight. I would just challenge you as you read through the different feasts there that are identified in Exodus, each portrays some aspect of the ministry of Christ. The Exodus itself has messianic overtones to it, and we see glimpses of Jesus Christ. And one of the places I thought was very significant, when Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, 1 and 2, "For I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that our fathers were all under the cloud." You know what he's talking about now? He's talking about the wilderness wandering. "And all passed through the sea." There's that Red Sea miraculous. "And all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea." This idea that he's talking here about being baptized into Christ, and he's identifying by correlation that they were all baptized in the cloud, covered by the cloud, and in the sea, going under the sea, though on dry land. And then another place is in the manna and the water. In the John 6 passage, the bread of life discourse, Jesus says some pretty fascinating things, and it offends the people as they're listening to him. He says in verse 31, and I'm just going to pick out some verses here from that whole sixth chapter, "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Now this is where they're trying to bait him to feed them again. They're citing an Old Testament episode. It was, again, some of the wilderness wanderings, which was a high mark in Jewish history. Jesus answers, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." Again, they're still wanting some free meals. They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger. Whoever believes in me shall never thirst." And then again in that same sixth chapter down in verses 48 and following, "I'm the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. The bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." And so he is really challenging them to recognize that manna was not the be-all, end-all, and that the meal they just had miraculously where he took the lad's lunch is not the be-all, end-all. It is a powerful symbolism of who he is. He is the real manna. He talks about eating the flesh of the Son of Man, drinking his blood. "Whoever feeds on my flesh," let's see, what do we have up there? Verse 51, "The bread I give for the life of the world is my flesh." And so he goes on through this sixth chapter. "My flesh is true food, my blood is true drink." And then verse 58, "This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." So he is clearly, he is the manna. And then 1 Corinthians 10, again, Paul teaching on this matter, verses 3 and 4. "All ate the same spiritual food in the wilderness. All drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them." And then you get this amazing declaration. and the rock was Christ. We won't get in tonight in this passage to the theophanies, but we will be looking at some theophanies as we go through the Old Testament. Theophany is literally from the Greek, theos, God, phaneo, face, where God takes on face. And when God takes on face in the New in the Old Testament, it is the second person of the Trinity, the Son of God, who comes in a theophanic manifestation. We'll look at that in the fiery furnace, in some other areas, that rock was Christ. The rock is a type of Christ, and so he is manna. The manna anticipates him. The water in the wilderness that anticipates him. And then there's the tabernacle, and the tabernacle is very intricate. Chapters are devoted. Don't let yourself get bogged down. When you read through the passages on the tabernacle, read and ask yourself, what does that tell me about Jesus Christ? The colors, the royal colors, the splendors, the structure of it, all of it speaks of the person of Christ and the way of redemption. And it symbolizes things like suffering and blood and death, and beauty and holiness and glory. One fellow wrote, and I put this down, I think, in the notes, that the tabernacle is theology in a physical form. It's a statement about the person and work of Jesus Christ. And then, of course, the high priest. The book of Hebrews picks up on this a lot, if you're familiar with Hebrews. Chapter 4, verses 14 and following. Since then we have a high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. This high priest, language of high priest, and that for any Jew, and this was Hebrews is written to Jewish Christians, goes back to the office of high priest, one of them who served the tabernacle, and one time a year on the Day of Atonement, or Yom Kippur, would enter into the most holy place to offer sacrifice for the people. The role of the high priest was to go with pure hands, a clean heart. The Hebrew writer picks up on this picture. Hebrews 9, verses 11 to 12. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, watch the analogy here, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, i.e. the tabernacle, he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. It's a powerful shift of thinking. In Jesus, you have both high priest and sacrificial lamb. So the high priest does not so much offer a sacrifice, the high priest offers himself as the sacrifice. Hebrews 9, 24 to 28. For Christ has entered not into holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true things. Notice that the shadow and the reality. But into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. The high priest went into the most holy place, appearing in the presence of God, the Shekinah that would descend upon the tent of meeting, and he would go and represent the people to Jehovah. Nor was it to offer himself repeatedly. That's what the high priest, annually, every year, Day of Atonement. As the high priest enters the holy places every year with blood not his own, for then he would have had to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for man to die once and after that comes judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, because he's already done that, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. So you have this explosion in the book of Exodus of where we see Jesus anticipated, Jesus typified, Jesus foreshadowed. What about the contribution? What does Exodus give to us as we see these images of Jesus Christ and a lot of its narrative and its ceremonies? Exodus accounts for many of the religious ceremonies and customs of Israel, the creation of the tabernacle, the formation of the priesthood, the giving of the Mosaic law, the sacrificial system. Exodus is foundational for following the history of Israel. It describes how the Israelites escaped from Egypt, how it became the covenant people of God, came to know His presence and His ways. It's at the heart of the Old Testament as the greatest example of the saving acts of God before Jesus Christ comes to show us the saving acts of God. It provides the framework for the rest of the Old Testament message. I told you last week, if you misunderstand Genesis, particularly the first 11 chapters, you north on the compass is going to be messed up. If Exodus doesn't grip you, then you're going to really misunderstand a lot of the Old Testament. The Passover, the Exodus, Moses, the law, the tabernacle dominated the thought of Israel for centuries to come. And even today, Orthodox Jews. Exodus is full of God's powerful redemptive acts on behalf of His oppressed people. Yes, He delivers them at the Passover. Yes, He delivers them through the Red Sea. But the story of the Exodus is God blessing the people, them sinning against Him, Him judging them, and Him then delivering them from future danger. Continues the story that begins in Genesis with the 70 descendants of Jacob and moves through Canaan to Egypt. Exodus shows us that God faithfully fulfills His promise made to Abraham centuries before. Listen to this. We're going to close with this. Genesis 15, verses 13 and 14. Remember, in the context of God giving the covenant. Then the Lord said to Abram, "Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs." Can anyone say Egypt? "And will be servants there. And they will be afflicted for 400 years. Abram was told this, that his offspring would be in a foreign land afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possessions." You may remember that by the time they leave Egypt, the Egyptians are so terrified that the language that is used is they plundered the Egyptians. You get this picture that the Egyptians are giving them their stuff. Please go. Take this with you. We don't want to see you again. It was God's promise to Abram as a part of His covenant blessing that He would make him a people that were numberless as the stars in the sky, as the sands on the sea. Well, I think that's a good little sketch of the book of Exodus. Went a little longer than I anticipated. I will, though, if you want to take a few minutes, if you have any questions or comments or observations, we'll be glad to attempt to answer those. By the way, Georgia asked a question last week, which was an excellent question. So we did a little digging about this. Why was there evening and why was it evening and morning? And when I wrote her back, I said, I'm kind of embarrassed that I didn't think about this at the time. If you think about how the Jews mark time, when does the Sabbath day begin for the Jew? We know it's on Saturday. When does it begin? Friday night. When does it end? Saturday night. See, we think in more Greek and Western type terms that we know that midnight starts a new day, but we don't talk like that, do we? The day begins in the morning. The sun comes up. The Hebrews thought differently. And it is drilled into them in this language here, and they follow that. Even today, the Orthodox Jews, well, if you're ever in a home, by the way, of an Orthodox Jew, on Friday evening, you begin to shut down. If you haven't watched the movie Fiddler on the Roof in a while, you ought to just watch it. It's a great movie, by the way, but watch it for that. For when they're getting ready for Sabbath, and they're scurrying around trying to get everything ready Friday evening before the sun sets. When the sun sets on Friday, Sabbath begins. So there was evening and there was morning, and that's the way the calendar was run out. And then, of course, the Julian calendar came along and changed a lot of that. But it was an excellent question, and I appreciate Georgia asking that. Do you have any? So that's proof, by the way. You can ask any question you want. Don't pretend we have the answers, but hopefully we have resources we can find the answers and get back to you. Anybody have questions or comments?